are roaming around the world, taking in a remarkable range of people and places beginning with the letter R. Joining me tonight are Riding the Rails, it's Benjamin Zephaniah. Roving the Roads, it's Josh Widdicombe. Racing Down the Rapids, it's Sara Pascoe. And Running to the Restroom, it's Alan Davis. And let's go round the horns. A Benjamin goes. Josh goes. Sarah goes. Butch. And Alan goes. Right, let's start with a really riveting question. Who is this woman and what can she do?
She looks like my primary school teacher.
She's beautiful. Mm.
Does the audience know who it is?
Minus points already.
I know. It's a common misconception. So she was a poster girl, apparently, for women's contribution to the war effort in the Second World War. That's what it is commonly thought. The poster does date, in fact, from 1943, but it was actually used only for 10 days in the American Westinghouse factories. But it was part of a series of 42 posters, and the idea was to halt union activity. It was to prevent strike action. Then what happened was the poster was rediscovered in the 1980s and it was given a sort of new lease of life. The real Rosie the Riveter is based on somebody that you might have heard of. So that is the real Rosie the Riveter. Who do you think it looks like?
Is it Roseanne Barr?
I think it looks like Joe Brand.
Joe Brand.
Yeah. Not think.
Yeah.
But it is based on somebody famous. It's painted by Norman Rockwell. He based it on the prophet Isaiah from Michelangelo's Sistine Chapel. I know. You wouldn't
That's
think it.
That's rather cool, isn't
yeah.
it?
I know, it's absolutely marvellous.
So when you say we might recognise him because it's someone we know...
No, I said it was based on somebody famous. So
how famous is he?
Isaiah? Yeah.
I reckon they'd book him for this show.
Yeah. So Rosie is eating a ham sandwich. You can't quite see it in this picture, but her foot is crushing a copy of Mein Kampf. It was actually based on a 19-year-old telephone operator called Mary Doyle Keefe. She was paid $10 and she wasn't a riveter at all. But the image of actual Rosie the Riveter fell out of use due to copyright restrictions, and the gap in the market was sort of filled by the We Can Do It version that we saw earlier. The real name, Rosie the Riveter, came from a song, and we think we can have a listen to it.
Keeps a sharp lookout for sabotage, sitting up there on the fuselage. That little fair can do more than a mare can do. Rosie the Riveter, Rosie the Riveter.
I love that. That little frail can do more than a male. Makes you feel good about yourself, doesn't it? On the subject of QI panellist resemblances, I said how much I thought that poster looked like Joe Brand. In July 2018, there's a Twitter user called Sam Jordan, and he tweeted the following. Going through some old photos, a welcome surprise. Is in fact Alan Davis.
Wow.
Can you stand up next to it, Alan? Yeah. Let's have a look.
Well, I think she's gorgeous.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Now for a bit of Randy Scandi. Here are some words of Scandinavian origin. To be more specific, they're of Norwegian origin, since the Danes would never use such stupid words. You can tell me what they mean. Have a look at some of these.
Crotching is obvious.
Yes, what is it?
Michael Jackson does.
Oh, yes, like a bit of a move, a crutching.
Oh! Yeah. Oh, God, I thought you were thinking of a very different thing.
You're thinking of flash bun.
Yeah.
I saw something the other day online. I don't know if I can talk about this, because it's really dirty.
Darling, so,
come on.
You've already gone down to Michael Jackson's crutch.
No, it was, these people who... They're kind of pranksters, I guess, and they literally lick toilets.
What?
What?
Yeah.
As a hobby, like a sort of niche hobby.
I guess they get lots of likes and views on YouTube and stuff like that.
Wow, I mean, I've been worrying about shaking hands, but...
And you think that's flush bunking?
Sounds like a whiff swiddle to me.
Yeah. Well, I can tell you that biff squiggled means confused. Flush bunking actually means making no sense. Whiff swiddle is something that happens or moves very fast. And all of these words were invented by one person. Who do we think that might be?
A Norwegian person.
Well, of Norwegian origin.
Is it a footballer?
No, it is.
I'm out.
It's for the BFG.
Oh, Roald Dahl.
It is Roald Dahl. His parents were Norwegian immigrants. Roald Dahl is actually a very interesting fellow. He was a spy, briefly. He was a spy for the sort of covert operation set up by MI6 to spy in the United States. But he used his spy experiences to write screenplays. He wrote two Ian Fleming screenplays. He wrote the James Bond film You Only Live Twice and Chitty Chitty Bang Bang as well.
Oh. Wow.
But he made up over 500 words in BFG. Scrumptiddlyumptious.
Snozcumber,
yes, which was?
It was like a kind of bitter cucumber.
Yeah, it was a black and white striped
with little knobbles on the outside. I wish James Bond had eaten one of those instead of having a martini.
Have a snozcumber, please.
Slice.
Yeah, good mind. That is an incredible book. Published in 1982, it has sold over 40 million copies.
And
sells another million every year. I know, right?
The BFG does.
Yeah, the BFG, yeah.
One of the dreams in one of the jars is that a book sells so well that even footballers on the pitch, that everyone in the world is reading the book. And it kind of is like that, isn't it? Everyone's read the BFG.
Not footballers.
Dahl, when he was buried, I love this, he was buried with his snooker cues, some very good burgundy, chocolates, HB pencils and a power saw. Which I just think is...
What's he planning?
I don't know. What would you be buried with, Alan? What would, if you were to choose the bits and pieces?
I was going to say my children.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dad of the Year. Yeah, no, I don't think that's appropriate.
It's not.
What about you, Josh?
I completed a jigsaw for the first time this week.
Two-piece or what?
Yeah, how many?
I don't know how many pieces it was meant to be. 1,000.
Yeah.
It was 999 pieces.
Yeah.
So you didn't complete a jigsaw?
No.
Is this a brag about something?
Yeah.
You failed at.
I didn't fail,
You
but...
did, darling, because when you say you completed a jigsaw, that is not what happened.
You didn't complete it?
Yeah, thank you.
All right, I want to be buried with the final piece of the jigsaw.
Anybody else?
In Birmingham Museum,
yeah.
One of the exhibits is my first typewriter. And it's a typewriter that's almost 100 years old. I was a little kid.
Wow, you've aged well.
I was a little kid and this bloke looked at me and he went, what do you want to do when you grow up? And I said, I want to be a poet. And he went, well, here's a typewriter. And it's a beautiful piece. And I'd like to be buried with that so that when I'm decomposing, I'm still composing, basically.
Oh, I think that's nice. That's really nice. That the Birmingham Museum is going to be empty. What else have they got?
Yeah.
They've got Jasper Carrot's stool.
Oh, that's gone off by now, surely.
Not his stool.
Oh, I see. I mean, sweet of him to offer it, but.
This is the weirdest show I've ever been on.
I met Jasper Carrot and I asked him about why he's called Jasper Carrot, and he said that's because his real name is Davis. And it's so boring. His name is Bob Davis.
Is that right?
Yeah, and that's the name of my middle child.
You want to be buried with.
Yeah.
Now, on to the Romans. What did they ever do for us?
I know what they didn't do.
What did they not do?
I've seen this programme before.
Yeah.
They didn't build roads.
No, they really did.
They did.
Birth's life of Brian, they ask, all right, but apart from, you know, the sanitation, the medicine, education, wine, public order, irrigation, roads, a fresh water system and public health, what have the Romans ever done for us? In fact, most of those items on the list already existed. They were improved upon rather than invented by the Romans. So they didn't invent roads, but they did certainly make them.
Did they invent aqueducts?
No, they did not invent aqueducts either. They were used by the Egyptians and the Babylonians for hundreds of years before the Romans.
Underfloor heating?
I mean, again, there is underfloor heating in other parts of the
really?
World. Yes, I'm afraid so.
Pasta.
Pasta. They invented pasta. Absolutely. No, all sorts of things that we think. So, for example, straight roads is one of the things that we think, but we know straight roads existed in Ireland, which the Romans didn't even reach. They didn't even invent paved roads. The world's oldest paved road, which this is part of...
This one of Josh's puzzles.
It's probably 4,500 years ago that this road was laid down. It's in Egypt. So it was laid down in order to build the monuments at Giza along the Nile. There is something the Romans did give us, which is the Wicker Man. So the very first evidence that we have of the Wicker Man style of pagan sacrifice comes from Julius Caesar. He claimed that the Druids burned people alive inside wicker cages.
Oh, wow.
The thing is, he's thought to have invented it because he wanted to show how barbaric everybody was in Britain. Although maybe the Wicker Man has not... We have no evidence of it because...
Because they took it apart to make some cool chairs in the 80s.
Does anybody want to see a Peter Rabbit Wicker Man?
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh.
Okay, well... So, in 2016, they made a 40-foot... There it is.
Wow.
..straw statue of Peter Rabbit. It was created to celebrate the 150th anniversary of Beatrix.
And it's full of rabbits.
Well, it was set alight by arsonists.
Oh.
Or Mr. McGregor, which is the one I'm voting for. And we had a picture of it on fire, but I couldn't bear to show it.
Oh.
Shall we?
Oh.
No.
Shall
no.
we?
No.
Shall
no.
we? Shall we? Come on, you lot. What sort of rabble are you? You want to see the burning rabbit? Don't you?
What is wrong with you?
Rabbit, it's just a picture of a fire.
I'm not showing Peter Rabbit on fire. It's not happening.
Yeah. And so was it supposed to...
Wow, I'm being nice for the odd child who watches. It's not happening.
You're a very odd child watching this.
Yes, sir. But the welfare, the idea of welfare is a Roman concept.
Mm.
So they had something a bit like a sort of corn dole. So if the poor were really suffering, they would give out and look after the needy. And that is a concept that hadn't existed before.
I think there are some African scholars that would really disagree with that. Because there's lots of evidence that African villages used to share and they would never let anybody go poor. There's a Jamaican word called pardner. It's like partner, but pardner, where people put money into a kitty in the village, and it's to make sure that no one goes poor.
I think there's a serious issue in history that probably a lot of that stuff that happened was not written down, and so it has been lost.
Well, you know, this... God, I'm going to talk about what I teach at university, but I teach the oral tradition, and so a lot of it is handed down word to mouth.
Mm.
And a lot of Western scholarship just missed it because it wasn't written down.
No, you're absolutely right. Now, who would be the worst person to borrow a glove from?
O.J. Simpson.
The guy that gave me a strip search at Heathrow Airport, so wouldn't want to borrow a glove from him.
Did you do the whole... I don't know why I'm doing
really?
That. There's not that much movement in it.
You know, not changing a light bulb up there.
Yeah.
I was coming from a particular part of the world which is known as a source of narcotics, and I look suspicious.
Was it Kensington?
And they gave me a strip search.
That's hard.
That's awful.
Yeah.
What did they find?
They...
2 kilos of cocaine, but that's not the point.
They found nothing. I am innocent. I'm a good boy. I haven't
quite
broke the law for months.
A while. So I'm going to give you a clue. The worst person to borrow a glove from, he was Russian, he was romantic.
Oh.
His name begins with
Rasputin. That was a trick of the highest order, Sandy.
That's so much fun. Rachmaninoff. Sergei Rachmaninoff. He had huge hands. You should have keyboards.
Yeah.
So if you have a look at the keyboards, he could span 12 keys. So that is Rachmaninoff's hand that you have there. So put it up against your hand. He can span 12 notes. How many can you span with a single hand?
Oh, I got really smart.
I'm on 10.
You can do 10.
9, just about.
Just about 9. Yeah. And Sarah, what about you? Using all 5 fingers.
15.
So there is an argument that some of the virtuoso pieces on piano are inherently sexist because women simply can't manage.
Possible.
So there is an issue for women playing piano pieces because if you want to play large chords and so on, you really need a span of at least 8.5 inches, and that eliminates 24% of men, 87% of women. But there's very few women in the virtuoso piano playing.
I didn't know that.
And it's partly to do with the span of the hands. The world record for biggest hands held by an American, Robert Pershing Wadlow. Strangely astonishing, isn't it? His hands measured 12.75 inches, so 32.3 centimetres, from the wrist to the top of the middle finger. He's also the tallest man on record.
Okay. I was just going to say, is it to scale?
Yeah. He was 8 foot 11.1 inches. I mean, he was astonishing. You sometimes see a model of him outside the Ripley, believe it or not, museums.
Yeah.
And really sadly, he died quite young. He was still growing by the time he died. And his ankle brace chafed him and he got an infection and he died because... it's just really sad.
Yeah.
Right, moving on. What could this man do in 28 seconds? That's a silly laughter. Who's sniggering at the back of the class? He's Scottish. His name is Robert Liston. 19th century.
19th century?
He's a surgeon. He could amputate a leg in 28 seconds.
That's too quick.
Ooh. Yeah.
I can do it quicker, actually. What's that, half a second?
No, but you have to tie all the veins together.
Oh, you've got to finish the job.
Yeah, you've got to finish it off. His catchphrase was, "Time me, gentlemen." So, I know. In those days, theatres were called that for a reason because people sold tickets and they were spectators. Yeah. So what happened on this one particular occasion, it did not go all that well. One time he accidentally chopped off a patient's testicles along with his leg.
No!
Too high up the leg.
I know, right?
It's not too high.
On one occasion, he was doing the amputation, so you have to imagine he has to be fast because there's no anaesthetic. He brought the knife down, he managed to sever 3 of his assistant's fingers, and as he brought it back up, he slashed the cloak of a spectator. The patient and the assistant both died later of gangrene. Their wounds became infected. And the story is that the spectator died of fright because he thought he had been stabbed. It is the only operation on record with a 300% mortality rate.
Did he lose his licence?
No, darling. People queued up to see him. They absolutely did. Because his mortality rate was 1 in 7.
And 1 in 7?
Well, the average was 1 in 4. So, you know. But the idea that people don't make mistakes now, let me tell you. In 2019, a hospital in Leicester paid out £20,000 to a man they had circumcised by mistake. He'd gone in for a procedure on his bladder.
No.
He said he got distracted chatting to the nurses.
What?
Yeah, so he didn't notice he was having the wrong operation until it was too late. He described it as a real surprise.
£20,000, though. I'd take it.
Yeah. What was the biggest revelation in Bridget Hitler's diaries?
Hold on, is there really somebody called Bridget Hitler?
Yes.
You don't really hear much about any other Hitlers.
Yeah, I always thought that.
Just change your name to Carrot, it's much easier.
Can I just point out that we're not suggesting that Renee Zellweger is a Nazi? Can I just...
You have to do that at the start of every show, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, I do.
Just once again, Renee Zellweger is not a Nazi.
At the time of recording.
Yeah. But there was really a Bridget Hitler. She was married to Hitler's half-brother, Alois, in 1910, and they lived in Liverpool. And that is Bridget right there. And she wrote about her life with Hitler's half-brother. She claimed in her diaries that Hitler came and stayed with them. Academics dispute this, I have to tell you. But the thing that she revealed, which I really love, is that if Hitler won the war, what he wanted to do was to take Rochdale Town Hall, brick by brick, back to Germany. That was...
What?
Yes.
And that's what it was all about?
Yeah.
Why Rochdale?
Well, it is very beautiful, isn't it?
It does look beautiful.
And the Luftwaffe did use it as a landmark, so it was saved during the war. Ironically, the Luftwaffe destroyed Bridget Hitler's house.
Maybe Adolf Hitler didn't have a nice time when he stayed with her.
Yeah.
Let's go for Bridget's house. It's the third one from the end.
It's just the most fantastic Victorian Gothic architecture. It contains a toilet that has never been used because it was built for Queen Victoria, and as she didn't use it, nobody else has either.
They definitely have, sadly. Yeah.
Of course they have. Whoever's got the key...
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the idea of moving... You could have done this. You could have taken Rochdale Town Hall down and moved it to Germany. And there are lots of historic examples of big buildings being moved. Anybody remember when London Bridge was moved? Anybody know where it went?
United States.
Yeah. Yeah.
1976. It was put up for auction and was won by a man called Robert McCulloch, and he moved it to Arizona. It is now the second largest tourist attraction in Arizona after the Grand Canyon. Anyway, he paid $2.5 million for it, and it has certainly paid itself back, and he sold lots of residential property on the back of it and all that kind of thing. And the other one is Rosa Parks' house. So Rosa Parks famously...
On the bus.
On the bus.
Refused to give up her seat on the bus. That was in December the 1st, 1955. She later moved to Detroit to live with her brother, and that house, which was a tiny house...
They lifted it on a huge bunch of balloons.
No, it's in Berlin.
Oh, Berlin.
I know. Ooh. Isn't that the strangest thing? It was an artist called Ryan Mendoza. They were going to demolish it, and he couldn't bear it, so he bought it and he rebuilt it in Berlin, and he does sort of sound performances. You can't go in it, apparently. It's not safe.
Is it a tourist attraction?
Well, he does sort of... he's a performance artist, so he does performances in and around it.
The strangest tourist attraction I've ever been to was the Hotel Lorraine, or Lorraine Hotel. It's a hotel where Martin Luther King was shot. Oh. And I think they don't do this now, but when I was there, you could stand on the balcony where Martin Luther King was shot, and they literally had his footprints, so you could stand in them.
Oh, wow.
And a laser would shoot you.
No!
As if you would be shot just like Martin Luther King was shot.
Oh, my God, that's terrible.
There's an amount of time, like, in for the anniversary of the Titanic, to go full circle, there was a theme park ride that opened in Japan of the Titanic sinking. And actually, there's an amount of time where it becomes a historical fact and kind of empathy disappears.
Yeah. But I think it's really weird now that, you know, you have tourist attractions that... and pubs and things called Jack the Ripper.
Well, there's a whole cultural conversation now that's so much more about the women. Number one, poverty in London, the women who were in danger, sex work at the time, the history of London, that it isn't just about,
there's a new biography recently released, isn't it?
It's about the five women. No, it is very, very good. And now we've roamed way off course and right into the twilight zone of general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Which is the British lake with the greatest deepness? I'm going to give you a hint.
Yeah.
Its depth is absolutely monstrous.
Oh.
Yeah.
Windermere.
Good playing of the game.
Extra point for playing the game well. so it is not. It's not.
Loch Ness.
Oh, no, it's that is not fair.
I'm getting the hang of this.
The deepest lake in the UK is Scotland's Lake Morra. It is 310 metres deep. Loch Ness is 247.5. There is, however, in Loch Morra, a cryptozoological monster that rivals the Loch Ness monster. It's called Morag, which is so cute. It was last spotted in 2013. And the new theory about Loch Ness, actually, because there was a team of researchers from New Zealand in 2019 and they analysed water samples, they think it may be several giant eels that are living in the lake. Loch Ness gets its name from an old Scottish legend that featured the Gaelic lines, Ta Loch Nessan, Tha Loch Nessan, just means, there's a loch now, there's a loch now. Who knows? Loch Morra is deeper than Loch Ness and has its own monster to boot. Here's someone who's absolutely full of herself, but where was this doll invented?
Oh.
Yes, Josh.
Minsk.
Good answer.
Really specific. It's specific and it's wrong.
Oh, not me.
But we hadn't thought of it. they're called Matryoshka, but it started its life in China. So more than 1,000 years ago, and then to Japan. But then in the 19th century, a Moscow workshop called Children's Upbringing took this idea and they created their own versions of these nesting dolls.
I've got one at home.
Yeah.
And it's got me and then my wife and then my three children. And the likenesses of everybody are pretty good, apart from me. I look a bit ridiculous.
We've done this one, which we think looks like you. got the shirt on.
Yes, yes.
And then if we open it up inside... let me see if I can get them all out. So then we've got Benjamin, and then we've got...
We've got Liv and Alan.
We've got... Yeah.
And with Josh?
Josh.
Unbelievable.
There you are. And even smaller than Josh.
Is that you, Sandy?
Is me inside. And what's inside? Oh, it's a blue whale.
We should try and do that after the show.
Yeah. Now, where is the biggest rainforest in the world?
Brazil.
Oh, here we go.
Someone
had to do it.
So there are two types of rainforest. There is tropical and there is temperate.
Temperate?
Temperate.
Isn't that just a forest?
What is the thing that classifies a rainforest?
The amount of rainfall.
The rain, yeah, absolutely. So the largest one is in Alaska. It's the Tongass National Forest. It covers 17 million acres.
Whoa,
it is breathtaking.
That's big.
But you also find them in Australia, in Japan, in Iceland, and indeed in the UK. So Snowdonia, Devon, Cumbria, Northern Ireland, the west coast of Scotland, they're all temperate rainforests. It's about 6% of the Earth's land surface area, but it's amazing because it's home to 50% of these species of flora and fauna. The Amazon alone is home to 10% of all species, including this, which is one of my favourite things, the South American Goliath bird eater spider. It's the size of a puppy.
Oh, no, thank you.
Each of its legs is 1 foot long.
What?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, you've ruined my dreams for like a week. That is, you like
you
that
wouldn't
bird.
Show us a rabbit on fire.
I have got a friend who went to the world's largest rainforest, so if you want to know what it's like, Alaska. Okay, we've run out of time. As our voyage draws to a close, let's take a look at the range of scores. In last place tonight, rambling in the Rotherham rain with minus 23. It's Sarah! In fourth place, with minus 19, it's Alan. In third place, with minus 7, it's the audience. With minus 6, beating the audience into second place, it's Josh.
Yeah. Losers, losers, losers.
Tonight, relaxing in a romantic resort with 3 points, it's Benjamin!
I'm so happy to be here. I want to thank my mother.
Anyway, it's thanks to Sarah, Benjamin, Josh and Alan. I leave you with this holiday reminiscence from Henny Youngman. This hotel I once visited was incredible. The towels were so fluffy, I could hardly close my suitcase. That's all from QI this time. Good night.